creative response for me is our grand talent as human beings to transform our problems into opportunities to make the world work better for everyone, to really strengthen democracy and expand democracy, to reorganize and reimagine a society that really addresses the needs of the many as opposed to the few. Creative response really looks to mine the biggest and best ideas. And it's an approach that is rooted within individual consciousness, but connected to a greater understanding of discovering a new we, a society that thinks about others, a society that is embedded with the understanding that we are agents of an evolving history, and that our actions are indifference, or our indifference make history. And it's important to, through creative response, for me in particular, to engage as a historical agent of change. Everything that has come past informs the present and then shapes the future. And that's why it's very important to have an understanding of history. In many ways, I always say, for me in particular, coming from the United States, that we're kind of an ahistorical society. I call America, that America's a day. There's no past and there's no future. It is what it is in that particular day. And that's part of what allowed the rise of Reaganism to happen in the U.S. And in some ways, in the U.K. with Thatcherism, although I think that in Europe in general, there's a tighter connection to history and a longer connection to history. And what I mean by that is that under Reagan, or under that time, there was much talk about there was a greater past. It was better then, and that he would bring us back to that, that glorious past, and that the corruption was the rise of the New Deal particularly in our country, and for England under Thatcherism was the rise of the social democratic state. Dismantling those things were very important, and we see that what they started has continued at maybe a great and faster pace in the new millennium. We see the austerity measures all throughout Europe, and I think that comes directly from what Thatcher started in England and chipping away at all the gains of the social democratic state, public education and healthcare and things like that, and really great support for workers with pensions. I mean, that's all been under attack. So very much that ideology, which is embedded with this thinking that the individual is paramount, that there's no such thing as society, for example, Reagan always talked about that there was a new, that there was a new day dawning in America, and that America was a shining, city on the hill, which was what George Bush kind of took to another level after him as president. But each president or each leader that followed was constrained in a way by what Reagan and Thatcher started, Blair and Bill Clinton in particular. And then in many ways they went further in a way that Reagan or Thatcher could never dream of, which has created a greater breakdown of the kind of social fabric that unites us. And this idea of the individual being paramount has created a great deal of cynicism. And I think that cynicism is an overlay within our politics and our culture. And then within that, this idea that compassion is weakness. And I think compassion, tied to creative response, is perhaps our greatest human talent. This idea that we can think about others and that we have a shared common humanity, that it is important to build on that and to understand that, knitted together, that travels across borders all around the world. When you have an attack of that idea, of that action, because compassion is an action, that's a big problem to take on, because they've unraveled a lot of what is essentially our basic common humanity, our shared human spirit. And it's very much codified within all the social institutions, particularly in the United States. And I think, we've in some ways exported that out to the world, this idea that the individual is paramount and we should really not be thinking in this collective way, what I call the new we. And I think that the artists or people engaged in creative response in particular are at the forefront, the bulwark against that. You know, and that kind of tension has existed since the beginning of time between those leaders like the Reagans and Thatchers. There's always been Reagans and Thatchers, and there's always been creative responders, you know. And that tension always exists. And I think that the beautiful part of that is some people will call that hope. But, you know, I would call it another word for hope for me is survival, or this idea that it's not just simply to exist, we must endure. And the human spirit, we have the evidence throughout history that it has endured. And, you know, and that's something that through, you know, creative response for me is continuing to give people the inspiration to aspire to make the human spirit the forefront of how we engage with each other through compassion and empathy and understanding and sharing. And, you know, this idea that we can dream and reimagine the world around us, you know. In my film, you know, not only do I talk about punk rock and rap, which were counterculture movements for me or in the 80s during this time, but I look at graffiti and skateboarding. You know, just to me, they're really powerful and profound creative responses because you're, you know, on a piece of wood with you know, these polyurethane wheels, and you're transforming the environment around you into something that is different than walking or driving through it. And that's a very, very powerful thing, you know. All of a sudden, you're seeing things in a different way that, you know, that you never could have imagined because you're experiencing it on this piece of wood, or, you know, the true public gallery of expressing yourself through graffiti. And, you know, those things to me are bedrock tenets of how a society not only exists, but expands and strengthens and really kind of does the hard work, you know, not to necessarily find answers and solutions, because I don't think that's really the goal, but to keep, you know, to keep finding the best ideas that move us forward. And that's how we own the future. That's how we create a language of the future. And I think an important element for me in that is this idea that creative response and this, you know, even being here at the Elevate Festival, is this breaking free of behaving in a traditional sense. You know, it's the permission to behave. It's the permission to ask the questions, what if and why not, and, you know, to kind of dream collectively together, you know, and to express ourselves in these passionate and emotional and engaging ways, which the, you know, the society can kind of constrain us in doing. I mean, Reagan and Thatcher were primary proponents of that, you know. You know, and I'd like to really kind of quote Ai Weiwei, who had a big influence on me, who I knew early on in New York City many, many years ago, who, you know, talks about it in this very simple way, which is, without freedom of expression, we don't live in a modern world, we live in a barbaric one. And I think that's a very important thing, because we see that under attack with what's happened with the NSA and the recent spate of whistleblowers. You know, that's a bedrock tenet of how we can survive on this planet. That really is the root that the tree can then grow and the branches of creative response can really spread. You know, we must have that, and we must really fight to protect it, but to also, you know, to make it the kind of dominant way we engage, you know. Because there's been a retrenchment of, you know, a regression of freedom of speech we see, you know, more and more and more, a control of it. And you know, there's a part of creative response for me that's about finding what I call the free space, the space that exists between the dominant political structure and the dominant cultural structure. And the free space is where we find ourselves here at Elevate. You know, this is the free space. When Picasso paints Guernica, or, you know, the Clash record London Calling, finding a free space. Public Enemy records It Takes a Nation of Millions That Hold Us Back. I mean, it's just, there's countless examples through history of that. And we need to continue to build the free space in that way.